I got faith, that's my shield. Long as I've got Jesus, I want you to tell me who. Tell me who.
Let's talk about some more current events. Oh, Bill Cosby, what's going on with him? The scandal. Do you believe it? Do you not believe it?
No. You think I would sit here if I would tell you I believe it? I wouldn't tell you. I don't know you that well.
No.
But I know it's a trick. You've been here long enough. No athlete can do anything they want to do, and nothing happens to them. Huh?
Right.
Big business pay the government $10 billion, but they don't have to admit they broke a law. Huh? Okay?
Mm-hmm.
DeSante, bottled water,
mm-hmm.
Coca-Cola. The largest fine in the history of Europe. They was fined $900 million because they take ordinary tap water purified with benzene and another poison. Nobody go to jail. Nobody go to jail.
Right.
And so consequently, let's look at Bill Cosby. Mm. Where'd they find all these women? They didn't know each other.
True.
And when they finally bring the judge in and open up the records, that happened after the 4th of July holiday. Huh? Judges don't work on the weekends. So where'd it come from? It came after all the barbecues and the Trump was back home. Here it is. The judge. Here's what the judge said. Told Bill, you should get you some more lawyers. The judge said that. Why? Because the judge said, well, give me a reason why I shouldn't open these up. He said it would embarrass Bill's family. His lawyer said that.
Mm-hmm.
What about the women?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay, but here's what happened. Bill Cosby was getting ready to buy NBC. White supremacy came in and said, I have a right to. Well, You see, there's a thing called racist white folks giving them a liberation holiday. That's what Cosby Show was. He didn't know it. Huh? You ever met a black person named Huskable? Dr. Huskable?
Huh? I'm sorry, I haven't.
Okay. That name don't threaten white folks. Huh? So when you put this show on and come out with facts, white folk can't wait to get the Bill Cosby Show. And so what you dig is complaining about, if it was like Bill Cosby, went to school, got a good education, look at your children. Them children be going somewhere on Saturday dressed up. Everybody else is going, rich white folk going to the park. That's what you call a liberation holiday. He's not aware of it. Huh? That was the game. A liberation holiday. Okay? So this show here, you put stuff out there, they can't get a liberation holiday. Huh?
Mm-hmm. It's uncut. It's pure.
Yeah, and so consequently, when the Bill Cosby thing hit, he was negotiating buying NBC. Oh, that's when he killed his son. You ever ask yourself a question? White folks loved Bill Cosby so much. They had commercials, man, where little white children was riding his back eating tapioca out of his eardrums. Daddy Bill. And so, how do they kill my son, and I can't get a commercial? No more Jell-O commercial. I didn't kill nobody. My son didn't kill nobody. What's this about? That's what it's about. He knew something that most folk didn't know. That Mercedes he bought him, they had reboots. They only had them, and anybody can get them now. You get a flat, it reboots its own self. That's technology. He knew that. Plus, you know what kind of fool you got to be to want to rob somebody on the highway? And that shit ended with stagecoaches, man. Huh? Cars traveling 30, 40, 50, 70 miles, and you going to wait out there to rob one? Huh? Then he gets out and calls a white woman. She shows up in a mink coat, and high heel shoes. To help him change the flat, when all you gotta do is push your button, the flat change itself. Bill knew that. Then if you look at the police report, I read it all. No robbery. Here's $6,000 cash, all his credit card, cell phone, no robbery. Then 6 months later, they arrested an American, but he's a Russian immigrant. So he did, when we checked that out, he was in Mexico that night. So Bill knows this. So now 30 years later, they just busted him.
Hannibal.
Huh?
Hannibal Buress.
Who?
The comedian, Hannibal.
Man, how come you ain't heard of him? They sent him there to do the trick, and you ain't heard of him. No more. Huh? It's a game. You never heard of him before? You haven't heard of him now. Bill Cosby and his wife wake up dead tomorrow. The world's convinced he committed suicide. You hear me? Discovery Channel. Bankrupt. Okay? The only thing saved it when Oprah couldn't do it was Halle Perry. Huh? Okay. They are bankrupt. Bill was thinking about... It's that simple. The Pope came to New York, went to Harlem. Al Sharpton wasn't there. Al Sharpton probably one of the most powerful Negroes in America because of the TV show 5 days a week. Radio show 3 hours a day, 5 days a week. He wasn't invited to Harlem at a black school. But he let them use him. Every time something went on with a cop and a black person, they bring him in, but don't give him the respect, huh? to say, come on to Harlem, man. We got just his friends, the mayor, huh? All that. Huh? It's a game.
Right, right.
Same thing with Tiger Woods. Tiger Woods got busted for the same reason as Bill Cosby.
Mm-hmm.
Huh? Tiger Woods had to win four more to tie Jack Nicklaus. Five to be the all-time. So he gets busted. I know somebody that saw when he came to the hospital. She told me if I didn't tell you this was Tiger Woods, you wouldn't know. It was a mob whooping.
Wow.
Huh? Now, so what did they do? They made deals. They said, Tiger, here's what we got. We got a law called the Mann Act, taking a woman across state lines for immoral purposes. We're not just getting you for that. That little 17 and a half year old girl you cared to watch you play tennis, I mean golf in Sweden, 20 years. Now let's sit like reasonable people. You can either do the 20 years, or we can make a deal now. You go back, play for a while, and on worldwide cameras, you're gonna pull something in your back so the whole world will see it. And then eventually, you have to retire. Last year, this time, and we talking about 2014, he was number one. Today, as we sit here, he's number 270. Now they've already talked about retiring. That's what this is about.
That's part of the fix. It makes me think of Michael Jordan's dad. He got killed on the side of the road.
Michael knew that. Michael knew that. They busted Michael. Michael ain't got no money. Michael broke. That's chump stuff.
It was like a gambling thing or something.
Can
like
you
that.
Know gambling? Broke. But they said, now we got this one Negro, so we don't have to get no more. His wife filed for divorce and they said, hey, you got no money. Why y'all just stay there? How did it come out? Because Michael Jordan, the restaurants he owned, he signed a contract where he would show up X amount of times a year, and they went to court and found he just had 2%. So when they busted him, shaving points. Then in the process, they said, oh, wow, man, Magic Johnson's doing the same thing. So they said, oh, we're in trouble. That is basketball. So they made a deal. Magic, you say that you have AIDS and you won't get out. He kept gaining weight, man. Then the next thing you know, he was killed. Well, how come all them billionaire white folks that's dying from it didn't follow him? He never had it. Okay? And that big scandal with the basketball owner out there.
Oh, yeah. Sterling.
Yeah, Sterling. That's a lover's quarrel.
Absolutely.
And he said, and Magic, you ought to apologize to the black community. Of course, he know Magic just get 2% of that. See how it works? Yeah. So here's what they did with Michael. Found his daddy dead in a car. So I go talk to a couple of state troopers. They say in the car, he just bought that car for his dad. And the name of the salesperson in Illinois, his car was up there. Voted Magic and all, and said, well, we're gonna get out. I'm just taking this, is too hard. So he went to say, you wanna play baseball? And once he cooled out, stay in shape, then he comes back. When Magic tried to come back, Malone said, I won't be out there playing with no AIDS. It's a game. And they arrested a black and an Indian who's in jail now. Somebody tape your two thumbs together. Your thumb, not your brain. You can't change your baby diaper, you can't comb your hair, you can't drive. Those two, right there, huh? That right there. Ain't nothing you can do. You can't unlace your shoe. You can't change your baby diaper. You can't cook. Those two. Huh? But they got you thinking it's your brain.
For me, I feel that what Sidney was allowed to do in the heat of the night was the start of blaxploitation.
Bill Cosby, accused of allegedly raping over 50 women. The majority of these women that he supposedly raped was white. Now, of course, I have a lot of black followers, and there are a good amount of white followers that support what I do as well. But I have to be myself for a second. Bill Cosby, a 78-year-old man born in 1937. This man lived through the front line of Jim Crow. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm scratching my head on some of these things. Now, don't get it twisted. I'm well aware of rape victim issues and happen to know quite a few myself, but that's beside the point. This is simply a situation where you have to use common sense, because obviously a lot of people don't have that nowadays. Now, they say over 50 women accused Bill of rape and came forward. And not all of them are white. Some happen to be black as well. But just to be lenient with things, I'm going to say 20 white women came forward, okay? Now, let me clap my hands, because I don't think that you guys understand just how many 20 is. Really, nigga? So y'all gonna just sit there and avoid the fact that this shit may not be adding up? I don't give a damn if there were 50 women that came forward. Anytime when you're an entertainer, a black male entertainer at that, with super high wealth, lying-ass vultures are gonna come out the woodworks.
Oh, come on, bruh. Over 50 women stepped forward, bruh. I'm pretty sure he raped at least one of them, a couple of them.
Look, one thing you guys don't understand is that conspiracy is real. The reason why people don't believe in it is because if you're a person with average thoughts that stay glued to the television set, then of course you're not gonna believe the behind the scenes true stories of what goes down, because you've never once stepped foot outside the box and never really had to. I don't like using this thing, but it's true. White supremacy runs shit. Not all white people mean harm towards black people. White supremacy run everything. These are their TV stations, their networks, their radios, their newspapers, their magazines, and their niggers who happen to control whatever whenever they decide to hit the button. Hell, damn near everything is owned by them. All these accusations on Bill Cosby, but no one has yet once found evidence. No one has found out one piece of evidence of rape between 20 to 30 years. Let me tell you something. You and I both know that it don't pay shit for a nigga to get thrown underneath the bus. Hell, all a black man gotta do is cough and a white woman can run off and say he raped me. And I guarantee without no question he will be gone. And that's if they don't blow his brain out of his skull. I've never once seen a highly successful black entertainer die in high wealth. They got Whitney, they got Michael Jackson. I pray Denzel, Michael Jordan, Will Smith, and Oprah make it to the end without getting a book thrown at them. Why do you think people like Will Smith, Denzel, Samuel, and all these other high profile black celebs don't go out often? Because they understand the world that we live in. That's why you never hear about them cutting up. All they do is do their work and go the fuck home. Bill, on the other hand, was out here making all kind of noise over the years. You know, just like I know, that they hate when you do good for your own people. And they hate it when you're vocal. And most of all, they hate it when a black man with money make purchases that quote unquote out of their lane. Bill Cosby tried to buy NBC a couple of times. They slammed the door right in that nigga face. Why? Because if he had gotten it, there would have been a whole different perception and outlook on black entertainment. Because he was ready to open the door for brothers and sisters. You ain't got a light bill, but support the work that he put in. You saw what happened to Michael Jackson. Bought the Beatles catalog and they never let him rest after that. They kept fucking with him until they got what they wanted. These motherfuckers will build you up, smile on your face, sip champagne with you, just to break your motherfucking ass down and take your cheese clean away from you. It's all about money. A man that's worth $2 million and $1 million and under won't be getting away for this long. Like I said, I'm just being lenient. Instead of saying 40-something white women, I gave the benefit of a doubt and said 20. Tell me, what sense does it make for a black man who's accused of these horrific crimes now? Don't you know that all Emmett Till did was whistle at a white woman just for his mother to look at him in a casket and not look like the same person that left her house before he was killed? All he did was whistle. But nobody got on Woody Allen when he raped his adopted daughter. He's still here today clean, and nobody made a big fuss about that. This is America. You think the white man is playing about his women? And it's sad because Dylan went in the church and killed 9 black people and got a bail for $1 million, the same amount that Bill Cosby got. But Dylan was treated good and taken to Burger King. The officer that raped 13 black women. What about him? I ain't hear nobody going hard in the paint for that. And it's sad because I'm all for supporting my black women. But how many of these black feminists stepped up when that officer raped those 13 black women? huh? But when we talk about Bill Cosby, black feminists want to come out of the woodworks and say he deserved it. Look, there are two types of people that probably wouldn't even care to look into the Bill Cosby case to see if he's actually innocent. That's women who's been raped and feminists. Of course, white women aren't going to speak up for Bill. I ain't found one yet. Because many of them are feminists and quite frankly don't care. They want to see him gone. But tell me, where were these women? Where were these women, these white feminists, when these 13 black women got raped by that officer? But instead, you choose to go after Bill. Look, I don't know everything, but I do know some bullshit when I smell it. And something just ain't right. One thing I know, when white supremacists know for sure that a nigga done did some fucked up shit, they will go out their way and lose sleep just to prove it. We'll see what will happen during his trial. Let's see how this plays out.
I mean, I'm a conspiracy theorist to a degree. Like, when I connect dots that maybe shouldn't be connected, I don't know. But certain dots, like when I see that they put every black man in the movies in a dress at some point in their career, I'll be connecting them. They're like, why all these brothers gotta wear a dress? This happened to me. I'm doing a movie with Martin.
Yeah.
The movie's going good. So I walk in the trailer. I'm like, man, this must be the wrong trailer because there's a dress in here. They come in, the writer comes in, I think he's the writer, he's like, Dave, listen, we got this hilarious scene where Martin's sneaking out of jail, so he disguises you as a prostitute. And he put this dress on, and what? A prostitute? Nah, I'm not doing that, I don't feel comfortable with that. That should have been in a discussion. What? You don't feel comfortable with it? I mean, it's a hilarious bit. All the greats have done it. So, well, if all the greats have done it, it's kind of hacky, right? You're right. So why don't we just not do it? Because I don't feel comfortable wearing a dress. Oh, come on, Dave. Listen, we got it all set up. We're supposed to shoot. Every minute you waste costs this much money. You know, the pressure comes in. He said, I'm not wearing no dress, man. I'm funnier than a dress. Just give me something funny to say. I don't need to wear no dress to be funny. What am I, Milton Berle? Blah, 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 blah. You know, we're going like this. And then finally, he's like, and he leaves. And then, like, the director comes, Dave, it really would be great if you wear the dress. What is wrong? What is this, Brokeback Mountain in here? wear the dress. I don't want to wear the dress. I want to wear this dress. You know what I mean? This guy's so difficult. They leave. Now the producers comes. Come on, David, would be so great. I mean, and then I started thinking about it. All the comics that I've seen, man, you know, strong brothers, why are you putting us in these dresses? But the minute it was clear, I was adamant, I'm not wearing a dress. I'm not wearing the dress. All right, fine. Think of something else. That comes back 10 minutes later. The whole new scene, how did you write the scene so fast? You know, it's like, so you got to take a stand.
Every racial group, every political group has always made money off of black folk. Okay? And what I'm going to start talking about in Powellnomics when I come back here in the fall is to show you all one thing. I'm going to tell you is time is up. You have made, as a race, you made every religion, every ethnic group, every racial group rich. There is nobody else left on earth to make rich but yourselves. So that's all left. We got to do it for ourselves now. So don't give me this stuff about Dr. Anson. That's the reverse discrimination. We are anti. You ain't anti nobody. You already made everybody rich. Now we're talking about, Dr. Anson, what you're preaching isn't that a segregation? Let me tell y'all something. Starting again, back in 1850, blacks got hung up on that same mess, you know? By 1850, after Harriet Beecher Stowe put out her book, here comes Frederick Douglass. He's going to take one path. He's going to go back now and try to pick up becoming an integrationist. He becomes an integrationist, picking that. He wants, well, since they excluded us in 1638, saying we should never be permitted to enjoy the fruits of white society, let's be integrationists and civil rights people. Let's make them let us in. So they started that top strand called integrationists, which will run Frederick Douglass, Booker T. Washington, then up to all your civil rights leaders and Martin Luther King and that whole group, all the way down the line to even your present day civil rights groups. They keep saying, we want access to whatever you own. We want to be included in whatever you own. Now you got another group that started after the book with Harriet Beecher Stowe. They said they want to be segregationists. Then you got the more strongly willed persons like W.B. Du Bois. Then you got Martin Delaney. You got Marcus Garvey. then you got Malcolm X and Elijah Muhammad. They were going the other way saying, no, we want our separate stuff. Now, what I say by myself, and I know a lot of people might get upset when I say it, both groups were right and both groups were wrong. What I say is that it is not about integration. It is not, the issue is not segregation. The issue is congregation. It means aggregating. What it is called functional pluralism, which means we're not trying to integrate, we're not trying to segregate. No other group comes here and says, I want to integrate or segregate. What they're saying is that if I come together and concentrate as a people, concentrate my power and my wealth and my resources, I can compete. That's what they're talking about. And please, as I love all of you, and I'm going to move you with you, don't let them trick you all anymore with them upside down glasses. They used to ask me that during integration about Dr. Anson. Now, hold it. Now, you're at the governor's office in Florida. You represent the whole state in education. Now, what do you want during integration? You got Malcolm X talking about segregation. You got Martin Luther King talking about integration. Why don't you all make up your mind? Which do you want? I said, I don't want either one. I want the same rights and privileges that everybody else got to go to either one of the sticks. Don't try to put me on one end of the stick. What I want more than anything else is to bring my people together and say, get all the power and wealth together like everybody else. And that way, quit trying to try to define us. You see, every Asian, for instance, when he leaves his homeland, he comes to America. He looks in the mirror and says, I'm going to America. And when I get to America, I'm going to find me a community of people that either look like me, or I'm going to build me a community of people that look like me, that have my values, my culture, and my language. Nobody asks him about integration or segregation. When Hispanics come to this country, they will say, I'm going in, I'm going to build me a community of people that look like me or sound like me. And like the Asians who set up Little Cambodias, Little Vietnam, Chinatowns in every city. The Hispanics come in, they'll build Little Mexicos, Little Havanas, Little Hialeahs. I can go across America and find German towns, French towns, Greek towns, Polish towns, but I can't find a black town. Because of our inappropriate behavior pattern with the Rodney kids, we keep trying to integrate. Nobody else is trying to integrate. Why would you try to integrate? And I just told you in 1790, the law says in the Constitution that the majority will win and the minority will lose. If the majority will win and the minority will lose, why would you ever do anything that breaks yourself into smaller pieces when you're already a plan, systematically programmed minority? Now you got other people in a category called minority. You got women, gay, Hispanic.
As we catch, came directly from Maryland. And if you think Ebola is something, they're working on diseases that'll make Ebola look like the common cold, brothers and sisters. So what do you do about that? Well, one thing you do about that is you stop taking these damn immunizations they want you to take. To my elders, stop taking the flu shot. Elders, stop taking the flu shot. They're giving you time-release cancer, and they're giving you time-release heart disease, and they're giving you time-release epilepsy. They're killing y'all. And stop immunizing your children. They don't need it. And they cannot force it. You have a legal right to refuse it. Now is not the time to take anything from white folks. Here's the question of the day. Why would the people that's trying to get rid of you give you something to help you live long? Anything they give you feeds the extermination agenda. Make no mistake about it. For brothers and sisters who give blood, be careful about giving blood. There's some evidence that suggests that they're poisoning people with disease while they draw the blood out of your body. If you gotta give blood to a friend or relative, you do what you must. We have to look out for family, but be careful with whom you go to the gate. Be very careful. For those of you who have volunteered to be organ donors on your driver's license, I suggest you reverse that. I suggest you reverse that. They're killing black people out here for organs. And if you are an organ donor on your driver's license, you're basically telling white folk, if you need a body part, here I am. If you want to donate your body for the sake of another person's life, write it into your will. In the event that something happens to me and somebody I know or love or who is of my race needs something I have, then you can give it as long as they don't owe me any money. But it's important that we not let the American racist system use our body parts to help white racists live longer. Imagine your heart in a white man's body who's working against the best interests of black children. Imagine your kidney, your spleen in a white person's body helping them live long enough to kill more black folks. We got to wake up. White people have never stopped being who they were. We just stopped seeing them for what they were. And that is the weakness. White supremacy's number one victory is it does what? It convinces the victim that the oppressor has changed his ways. If you think white people have changed, I ask you one question. If you think our relationship to white people have changed, I ask you one question. What is the general power relationship between black people and white people, and has it changed one iota since slavery? Not at all. They are still in control of the institutions. They are still in control of the wealth. They are still in control of every aspect of society that black people need in order to survive. Stop reducing racism to individual white people. Stop defining racism as a negative attitude. Do you realize half the white racists in this country do not exercise negative attitudes towards black people in their face? They work with you. They smile at you. They even marry you. It's important that you keep in mind that white supremacy is a military science. And what is the essence of military? Deception. And white folk are deceiving black folk into thinking that they have changed. So many black folk running around defending white people. Well, it's not all of them. How do you know? Have you met all of them? Well, Dr. Umar, it's not always about the white man. You're right. It's about the white man, the white woman, the white child, the white grandma, the white institution, the white church, and everything else. It's about all of them. For my biracial brothers and sisters, you belong to the family. But you must identify openly the fact that you belong to the family. The issue that we sometimes have with our biracial brothers and sisters is that some of you haven't made up your mind to be unapologetically African yet. You like to be black on the weekends and white when you're with your white family. And so what we're saying is you have to make up your mind whether you're going to be black all day long or just black when it's convenient. Make up your damn mind.
black man, stop going outside your woman. In D.C., y'all got it crazy down here. Black men love anything other than a black woman. You gotta stop it. And it has nothing to do with hating white women. I would never want to disrespect another human being. A little white girl should not feel inferior to my daughter, and my daughter shouldn't feel inferior to a little white girl. But we don't support it, not because we hate anyone, but because we love black women. That's why we against it. That's why we against it. Brother, if you go outside your race, you are exercising your value system. You're not exercising your options. You're exercising your value system. You're dating white because you consider it to be superior. You're dating white because you feel by having a white woman, you somehow feel a little bit more equal to the white man. So you have a racial self-esteem complex. And then you bring children in the world who grow up, our biracial brothers and sisters, who suffer like hell psychologically. I know because I do therapy with them in the schools. They don't know where they fit. The white people don't want me. The black people don't trust me. Why would you do that? Why would you do that? Put a child to that kind of a situation. Some of my biracial brothers and sisters know how difficult it was to come to that realization that they was African. Being raised by a white mother who don't want to accept the fact that she gave birth to black children. Raising a child is biracial, multiracial, quadracial. There was no biracial in slavery. There was no multiracial in slavery. Now all of a sudden, they give us a whole bunch of names so we can fight against each other with these false divisions and categories. Brothers and sisters, we have to go into the new year the right way. We have to bury all the petty differences that we have with each other. Now's the time to drop all the weight. We gotta drop the weight. We gotta stop fighting over ideology that's played out. If you wanna be a Moor, be a Moor. I don't have a problem with it. I will work with you if you're serious. You a Hebrew, be a Hebrew. I will work with you if you're serious. Last night in Jackson, Mississippi, a whole bunch of my Hebrew Israelite family came out to show me love. When I was in Virginia, a whole bunch of my Moorish family came to show me love. When I was in Greensboro, my Nation of Islam family came to show me love. I'm a Garvey, I'm a Pan-Africanist, but you don't have to be. I just want you to be serious and sincere about doing something about the problems that we have. And the conscious community has to take a long, hard look at itself. We are slowly becoming another megachurch. The black conscious community is becoming another megachurch. We have become exactly what we claim we were created to provide an option for. We talk about the preacher who sells religion but don't give the people no services. Well, we sell culture and we don't give the people no damn services either. We ain't no different. We ain't no different. We ain't nothing but a new school hip-hop industry. We might as well get inside the Bad Boy or some shit. Running around talking, running our mouths, giving out personal opinions to people, but we not building nothing. What good are we? What good are we? People can't live by information alone. We can learn all damn day, but until we do something about the situation, nothing going to change. You using culture to escape your political responsibility. That's no different than the pastor who uses the Bible to escape his. Who you fool? We suffer from information overload. Information overload. Information addiction. I don't want to do nothing until I know everything first. We can build after I finish watching all of the Dr. Umar DVDs. We can build after I've read all of Dr. Ivan Van Sertima's books. We can build once I've mastered the information in hidden colors. We are at war. And we don't have a luxury for you to get your learn on when we're trying to survive. Survival is first, and in your downtime, you get your learn on. You don't get your learn on first, and in your downtown, try to survive. That's ridiculous. That's ridiculous. Brothers and sisters, let us be clear. We know
that the white man is genetically recessive. We know that.
Yes.
We know he's the devil incarnate. We know that. We know that he is spiritually deficient and don't know how to treat anybody else. We know that. But let us be clear. What he's doing to Africans, he's not just doing it because he's spiritually deficient. He's not just doing it because he don't have melanin. He's not just doing it because he just came out the cave a few thousand years ago. He's not just doing it because he's a devil. The white man is doing what he's doing to black people because he can. Because he can. Because you let him. Frederick Douglass said, those in slavery who were whipped the most were the ones who could be whipped the easiest. We determine how poorly the white man treats.
Do. And we got this other thing that's also been working for a long time where you don't have to be racist anymore. It's called self-hate. It works on itself. It's like real estate of racism. Where just like that, when someone comes up and says something like, I am a God, everybody says, who does he think he is? I just told you who I thought I was. A God. I just told you. That's who I think I am. Would it have been better if I had a song that said, I am a nigga? Or if I had a song that said, I'm a gangster? Or if I had a song that said, I am a pimp. All those colors and patinas fit better on a person like me, right? But to say you are a God, especially when you got shipped over to the country that you're in and your last name is a slave owner's. How could you say that? How could you have that mentality?
Did you ever look up the word black in a dictionary?
For what?
Did you ever study anything that wasn't part of some con?
What the hell for, man?
Come with me. Black, destitute of light, devoid of color, enveloped in darkness, hence utterly dismal or gloomy, as the future looked black.
Pretty good with them words, ain't you?
Soiled with dirt, foul, sullen, hostile, forbidding, as a black day. Foully or outrageously wicked, as black cruelty. Indicating disgrace, dishonor, or culpability. And there's others. Black male, black ball, black guard.
Yeah, well, that's something, all right.
Let's look up white. Here. Read.
White. Of the color of pure snow. Reflecting all the rays of the spectrum. The opposite of black. Free from spot or blemish. Innocent. Pure. Huh. And there's something. Without evil intent. Harmless. Honest. Square dealing. And honorable. Wait a minute. But this is written by white folks, though, right? I mean, this is white folks' book.
This sure ain't no black man's book.
So what we reading this one for?
Because the truth is lying there. If you read behind the words. You got to take everything the white man says and use it against him.
Yeah? All right, I mean, you know, there's a whole lot of words in here.
Here, let's start at the beginning. We'll look them up, write them down, and find out what they mean. Here, page one. The first word, aardvark.
Aardvark, earth pig, African ant-eating mammal. Abacus. Chinese calculating instrument. Abaddon. The place of the lost in Sheol. The bottomless pit.
If you take one step toward Allah, he will take two steps toward you.
Good evening, your Black World family, Breaking Brown family. And I just want to say I wasn't even going to talk about this subject, but I had to. Mr. Steve Harvey has created quite the spectacle. There are memes on top of memes on top of memes right now going around making fun of Mr. Steve Harvey. Now, I have to say, you know, we all know if you've been under a rock today, you may not know that Steve Harvey totally botched the Miss Universe pageant when he crowned the wrong person, the wrong young lady, Miss Universe. It was supposed to be Miss Philippines. He crowned Miss Columbia. Then people online, the Colombians, started calling him the N-word, and they totally dragged him. I mean, he got roasted. And I've checked the internet, and at last I checked, he was still getting roasted. And I just wanted to say a couple words. You know, like I say, this mistake could have happened to probably anyone. But the key here is something bigger than that. First of all, he didn't just do what he did in terms of crowning the wrong people. Then he took to Twitter and misspelled Colombia as well as Philippines. He apologized to the contestants as well as the real winner, Miss Philippines, and he spelt it Philippians. As in the Bible, I think, praise the Lord. I'm not a Christian, but he really made a mess. He made a fool of himself. And the point that I want to make is not even about what Steve Harvey did in terms of making a mistake at the Miss Universe pageant. I could care less about the Miss Universe pageant. I could care less of how it happened, what got botched, who got hurt. I don't care. The question for me is, I remember a while back, long time ago, I remember Steve Harvey going in on, and I can't even remember who he was going in on, whether it was Michael Eric Dyson, Tavis Smile, I mean, whether it was, not Michael Eric Dyson, whether it was either Tavis Smiley or Cornel West he was going in on and saying, you know, because they wanted to meet with the president. Well, I haven't met with the president. The president ain't got time to meet with you. Who do you think you're talking to? The president ain't got time for that. And what I found is that Steve Harvey, you know, became the guy, in addition to kind of like Tom Joyner, he became this guy that black people were taking advice from. Political advice, real political advice people were taking from Steve Harvey in terms of who the president should meet with and how the president should set agenda and the president's priorities. And You really have to take a step back after this whole thing of not only him. I mean, because let's be honest here. If you look at the cue card said first runner up, second runner up, winner. No runner up is ever a winner. If you are first runner up, second runner up, you are not the winner. Runner ups are never winners. So it's a little iffy in terms of how he messed that up. But you have to ask yourself how easy it is for us to pick people to listen to. They don't have to have, you know, we got really good black academics out here who are writing stuff that's empirical. I mean, right now I'm reading Lester Spence's Knocking the Hustle about the black turn of black politics and the turn towards neoliberalism. We have some good people out here, some good scholars out here who are writing some good things. So I have to wonder about black people who are taking political advice. I'm not, if you want to watch Steve Harvey tell jokes or if you want to watch Steve Harvey on the Family Feud, that's pure entertainment. Great, fine. But how is it that this guy who couldn't get the Miss Universe, who couldn't read the Miss Universe cue card, is the person that at the beginning of Obama's term you were listening to for advice? That you were listening to for advice on politics. How did you do that? How did we do that? I didn't do it because I never listened to him. But how did we get there? We were listening to these people about stuff that matters, about stuff that is important. You know, and they have, you know, and they can't read a cue card. He's a comedian. That's fine. Comedians mess up. Academics may mess up, but academics have, you know, people like me may mess up. I'm not perfect. I make mistakes. We all do. But I'm just saying, look at God. I mean, can we be a little more selective in terms of who we listen to and who we take advice from on matters that are intensely important? I don't give relationship advice. Steve Harvey does. But I'm saying a lot of what, like when you look at the success books that a lot of these people have, it's nothing but warmed up, feel good stuff about working hard and you can get it. And I have news for you black people. There are a lot of people who worked hard their whole lives, all their lives, and died poor. There are people who were trying to do the right thing in the ghetto and got shot. There are a lot of those people. So this idea that, you know, you can put up a secret board and you can put things that you want on this board and envision this board, and that's the only thing. The only thing standing between you and what you want is a belief and blah, 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 blah. I mean, that's just trash. People are just selling us trash. And then you have Steve Harvey. This is the same guy. I mean, it kind of felt appropriate. The same guy who said, I don't give a damn about slavery. And what else did he say? He said something else. He said, you know, he was doing an interview with Kevin Costner. He said, well, you know, you can say racist stuff and not necessarily be a racist. I mean, he's a Christian. He's been very forgiving about these sorts of racial things. And he don't really see them as an issue. So I really wonder how Steve Harvey feels right now while about getting dragged by Twitter, by racist Twitter. He put up a Facebook post of him getting into a private jet. And so to me, that says it all. That's the key to everything. It doesn't matter if you have a problem seeing, if you have problems reading. None of this stuff matters if you give bad political advice. Because I really don't care that he made a mistake on the cue card. My thing is if that's what you're doing, if you make a mistake, fine. But what does that say about the kind of mistakes you can make in terms of politics, and you shouldn't be weighing in that area? But, you know, it just says so much. You know, and like I said, he put up the picture, he himself getting into a private jet. You know, none of this stuff matters because I got money. You know, I can't make a mistake. I have a private jet. I got more money than you. So it don't matter what I do or how I do it, I'm going to be all right. I got money. I got a jet. I got a Bentley. I got all this stuff. So it don't matter what I know or what I don't know. I can walk away from a conversation and not know anything. I'm averse to books and that sort of thing. And that's just the way it's going to be. And I'm better than you because I got money. I mean, that's what it says, and we kind of buy into that too. I've had arguments with people, and I say stuff like, you know, this person is wrong about X, Y, Z. Well, only thing I know is that he's a multimillionaire. How much money you got? I mean, we have to get out of this idea of determining a person's worth by how much money they do or don't have. And we have to get out of the eyes of out of this thing of, you know, deciding whether or not we want to take advice from a person based on whether or not we like that person or whether or not that person, you know, makes us laugh. You can be a congenial person and make us laugh and still not be the person that we need to listen to in terms of politics. So I think in terms of what happened, it was kind of, you know, it was a mistake at a silly pageant, not a big deal, but in the sense of like who are the people who determine, you know, what we listen to, what we think? Because Steve Harvey has influence. The guy has a talk show. The guy has a radio show. He has all of that stuff. So I don't even want us to get rid of Steve Harvey so much as expand who we listen to. We have a lot of people who share a lot of good information. Those people, some of those people are scholars. Some of those people are not scholars. Some of those people are people who just read books, because there's nothing. You don't have to be credentialed to be good at what you do. You know, I have friends who are not credentialed, but who spend a lot of time researching and reading and writing articles for different posts, for different blogs. So, I mean, just make sure this stuff is sourced and nobody's just selling you trash because it sounds good and it's going to make you feel good and it's going to sell a bunch of books, but it's not in any way tied to reality. Can we just change how we do things? And if somebody's a comedian, let's let them occupy that space. Like, they don't have to move into this space. If he makes you laugh, go see him, support him. I don't care. But like, don't let him come into this space and yeah, Steve Harvey right about Obama. But Steve Harvey doesn't know anything about policies, doesn't know anything about Obama, doesn't know anything about all of this. Except only thing he knew at that time was that he wanted to support the first black president. That's all he knew. So I think this is a good moment for black people to kind of reevaluate the categories and the sort of standards that they hold people to. I mean, if nothing else.
Again, since there has been so much trouble here in Brooklyn recently, especially at the Downstate Medical Center, isn't that what they call that place? The only why they call it Downstate. there has been a great deal of hope that the Muslims would condemn the so-called Negro preachers.
and their efforts to make the government and the city and the country give them equal job opportunities. The white man knows that this demand for equality of opportunity is just. He knows he has no defense against what he has done to black people in this country. He has no explanation, no justification. There's nothing he can say actually but keep his mouth shut.
Minister Malcolm X, how do you expect to avoid violence here in a gathering of so many people in Harlem?
Well, the Muslims who follow the Honorable Elijah Muhammad are never violent. We never initiate violence. And most of the black people in this country who are in sympathy with his teaching also develop a high degree of discipline and control of themselves and whenever they're in any gathering where Muslims are concerned. On some occasions, outsiders try and plant persons in our crowds to start trouble. But as of now, or up to this point, we've always, God has always blessed us to be successful in keeping these incidents at a minimum.
But what about these massacres of white people in Africa?
Well, I think that you can't start with the massacres. You have to go back. If there were massacres, which I doubt, you can't start there. You have to go back to all of the preceding events that led up to that. And I think that at the time the paratroopers went in, under the auspices of the United States, the American ambassador and a representative from the Stanleyville government were at that time carrying out peace negotiations that were headed by Jomo Kenyatta, the head of the Kenya government. And it was an insult to Kenyatta to ask him to mediate, and then while he was mediating, send in paratroopers. And I think that whatever resulted when the paratroopers landed is the fault of the paratroopers, the Belgian government, and the United States government. They provoked it.
Congolese have been massacred by white people in the Congo for years and years and years. And if the shoe is now on the other foot, only thing I can say is it's like chickens that always come back home to roost.
Do you personally feel, though, that there's some shame or involvement here or some guilt associated with the killing of other human beings?
I think that the white people should be ashamed of the deplorable situation that has been existing in the Congo, which is not the fault of the Congolese, but which is the result of instigation by European powers who are fighting each other over the mineral wealth of the Congo. And now to make it appear that the Congolese themselves are criminals or brutes because they're reacting to these injustices that they've been victimized by is again ducking the question.
Well, I think that because of the deplorable condition that our people have experienced in this country for the past 400 years, anything that any group does, any strategy that they use to bring this world spotlight upon the continued violation of the human rights of 22 million African Americans, well, I think they're justified.
In whatever they do?
In whatever they do. Since the government itself has shown its complacency in allowing the filibuster that's going on right now in Washington, D.C., to take place, and which is actually a debate as to whether or not the 22 million African Americans are really humans or citizens, as long as the government in 1964 allows such display to take place between senators and concerning the rights of our people, then anything that our people do to bring the spotlight of the world upon these continued injustices, they're justified in doing so.
I frankly believe that every Negro in the country should learn judo and karate.
How about carrying a weapon?
If it's legal for a man to carry or have in his possession a rifle or a shotgun, especially faced with what Negroes in this country are confronted with, they should have it. They shouldn't go out attacking someone with it, but in the face of the brutality that our people encounter, it's not unjust to teach a Negro to have a shotgun or a rifle in his house.
What if it were illegal to have a shotgun or a rifle in a
prison
zone? What if it were illegal? That's correct. Would you still advocate it?
We never advocate. I would never advocate anything illegal.
Even in an area where Negroes could be attacked?
I would never advocate anything illegal.
How long will you keep us up tonight, Malcolm?
We don't know. But in answer to your former question, are we recruiting? You don't have to recruit Negroes today. When a Negro is born in America, he's dissatisfied. And dissatisfied Negroes know that Mr. Muhammad makes the best spokesman black people can have in this country.
I would like to present to you the man of the hour, the messenger of Allah, the most honorable Elijah Muhammad.
The Muslims who follow the Honorable Elijah Muhammad don't see any way in which the so-called Emancipation Proclamation that Lincoln allegedly made 100 years ago has freed our people or has done anything good for our people.
Well, are you pro or anti Abraham Lincoln?
It's not a case of being pro or anti Abraham Lincoln. We're for freedom. And what Lincoln did never set the black people in this country free. Had it freed us, we still wouldn't be begging the president for civil rights and things of that sort.
Anybody who sticks a dog on us is a dog himself, and we'll get the four-legged dog as well as the two-legged dog.
Malcolm, a story under the byline of Aubrey Barnett in a current issue of a national magazine, says that the black Muslims are a fraud. What is your comment on this?
Well, Aubrey Barnett is a very intelligent person, and he has a fine academic background, and I think that the story in itself was very analytical, and it was objective, and it was true.
Another little money-grabbing scheme feeding on Negro frustrations. Is this true?
Well, if it is, and it is, and that's what it has deteriorated to, you still can't blame the Negro, and you can't blame the movement. You have to blame the society that let such frustrations develop until this is the result of it. I don't think any organization in itself can be condemned. The society and its shortcoming is what has produced an atmosphere that brings these organizations into existence.
He says there are probably less than 7,000 members now in the Muslims.
Well, it has fallen apart. No, thank you. It has fallen apart. And but what it has done in falling apart, many of those extremely militant and dissatisfied black Americans are now free to participate into the full swing of the struggle that's going on in this country, and I think it will be in to step up the tempo.
Are they in your movement?
Sure.
Every movement.
To address the first Congress of the Council of African Organizations, which was having its first Congress in London, and they were interested in knowing the rate of progress or lack of progress that the black man in America is making in his struggle for human dignity. So I was there and couldn't be here. And at moments, intervals during that time I was over there, I almost wasn't over there. I'm here today not as a person representing the religion of Islam. I'm not here in a religious capacity that goes above and beyond religion.
E il distacco dalla Nation of Islam sta maturando.
No, Martin Luther King, poor boy, is under the influence of the foxes. I should say under the control of the foxes, and has been used by the foxes to lead the poor sheep right to the slaughter. There are many whites who are trying to solve the problem, but you never see them going under the label of liberals. That white person that you see calling himself a liberal is the most dangerous thing in the entire Western Hemisphere. He's the most deceitful. He's like a fox. And a fox is always more dangerous in the forest than the wolf. You can see the wolf coming. You know what he's up to. But the fox will fool you. He comes at you with his mouth shaped in such a way that even though you see his teeth, you think he's smiling and taking for a friend.
Malcolm, you're one of the most ardent segregationists, white or black, around. Why are you lending your support to this school boycott?
No, I'm not a segregationist. I'm for separation. The white people in New York who have opposed the integrated schools are the segregationists. And I'm here in Brooklyn not because I'm for integration. I'm as much against integration as the white people in New York City are. But I am also against segregation. And I'm for separation. Separation is a system whereby the schools are operated by the black man. And it involves quality education. Then, in my opinion, the protest or boycott that Reverend Glamison is having against the segregated school system is a good protest. It's a good boycott. And my involvement doesn't mean that I'm for integration.
Malcolm X, what brings you here today?
Well, I'm out here to see the successful expose of the New York City school system. It proves that you don't have to go to Mississippi to find a segregated school system. We have it right here in New York City.
Are you supporting this boycott?
Yes, I did support it. I came as an observer, and I supported it because it shows that the problems that the white liberals have been pointing the finger at the Southern segregationists and condemning them for exist right here in New York City. The Negro leader in America today is on the spot when he thinks that he has to defend, that he has to satisfy the white man and the black man too. If you're going to lead black people, fight for black people. Fight for the satisfaction of black people. And you can't always do it and please white people. You can't please both. You have to please one or the other.
Okay.
For a man who is a Catholic president, who himself was discriminated against for a long time and accused Protestants of practicing religious discrimination, I think that he is way out of line to use his position now as the first Catholic president to open up his mouth against a religious group here in this country that is headed by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. If he's not going to open up his mouth and outright condemn the Citizens Council by name and condemn the Ku Klux Klan by name and condemn the white Masonic order, which is all white, by name, and the white churches in the South by name, then Kennedy is wrong to point at the Muslims because we are black and because we don't want to mix with the people down there. And I should say that when we express our desire not to mix with whites, they call us a hate group. And Martin Luther King is running around here telling Negroes to love all kind of white people, and they stick dogs on Martin Luther King. So it answers itself, and it shows the hypocrisy of the white man.
We too have been taught by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad that we were stripped
right.
of everything we had and been cast into the fiery furnace, a land where they've been making it hot as hell for us for 400 years. They call Mr. Muhammad a hate teacher because he makes your hate dope and alcohol. They call Mr. Muhammad a black supremacist because he teaches you and me not only that we're as good as the white man, but better than the white man. Yes, better than the white man. You are better than the white man. And that's not saying anything. That's not saying you know where I just to be equal with him. Who is he to be equal with? You look at his skin. You can't compare your skin with his skin. Why, your skin look like gold beside his skin. You find that old pale thing laying out in the sun, trying to get to look like you. That old pale thing.
In 1963, Malcolm X became national spokesman for the Nation of Islam.
Find him using man pain, trying to look like you. That old pale thing. You don't have any boats or airplanes bringing drugs into this country. The white man brings it in. The white man brings it to Harlem. The white man makes you a drug addict. The white man then puts you in jail when he catches you using drugs. In a vicious cycle of poverty, of ignorance, of apathy, of disease, and of death. And they have these old Uncle Tom Negro leaders coming to Harlem telling you and me that times are getting better. Your times will never get better until you make them better.
Une tête pour une tête, une vie pour une vie. Il faut que l'homme blanc sache que vous en avez assez de le voir tuer vos enfants, que vous en avez assez de ces massacres. Et dorénavant, ce sera la loi du talion. Ta vie pour ma vie, ton enfant pour mon enfant, ta femme pour ma femme. Et c'est alors seulement que les blancs arrêteront leur jeu criminel. Mais Malcolm X proteste. Nous ne voulons pas être intégrés à la société blanche américaine moralement corrompue. Nous croyons de toute notre religion que l'Amérique est entrée en décadence. Il va lui arriver ce qui advint à l'ancienne Rome, à l'ancienne Grèce, à la Perse, à Babylone, à l'ancienne Égypte, à toutes les sociétés qui furent fondées sur l'esclavage. Elle s'effondrera. Les États-Unis ne peuvent rien faire, ils sont fichus. économiquement, psychologiquement, intellectuellement, moralement, spirituellement. Bientôt les États-Unis sauteront et il ne restera que de la fumée. S'il y a une guerre contre la Russie ou la Chine, vos hommes défendront-ils les États-Unis? En cas de guerre contre la Russie ou la Chine, mais les Noirs ont combattu pour les États-Unis depuis la naissance même des États-Unis. Ils ont offert leur vie pour l'Amérique. Mais cette égalité, cette justice pour laquelle ils croyaient combattre dans les rangs des États-Unis, ils ne les ont jamais obtenues pour eux-mêmes. Chacun fera comme il veut en cas de conflit, mais je vous le dis, la prochaine bataille des États-Unis sera contre Dieu lui-même. Et vous, vous combattrez dans les rangs américaines? Moi, sur ma part.
The man that kidnapped us and brought us here, who made a slave out of us, who hung us on trees, who raped our mothers. I don't have to tell you which man. Because we intend to fire our people up so much until if they can't have their equal share in the house, they'll burn it down.
But I take it then you support the freedom-loving attempts of the peaceful marchers in Alabama and these places.
You don't get freedom peacefully. Freedom is never safeguarded peacefully. Anyone who is depriving you of freedom isn't deserving of a peaceful approach by the ones who are being deprived of their freedom. And when black people in this country come out from under the mental straitjacket that the Negro clergymen have placed them in, and begin to see that the only way you can get freedom is to get it the same way the white man in this country got it from England, or he says he got it from England. He was willing to pay the price for freedom. When you're willing to pay the price for freedom, then you get it. But the Negro in this country has never been willing to pay the price for his freedom. All of the price that we have been paying in the past has been freedom for the white man. We fought abroad so that the white man in America could be free today to stick police dogs on us, to beat our people in the heads with police clubs, and to turn water holes on little women and children and babies simply because they want to walk down the street like decent human beings. That's now the only way you can have peace is to eliminate those injustices, and the American white man is not going to eliminate them. He's going to talk that pretty talk, but he'll still continue to practice those inhuman deeds.
Well, one thing that's going on right now, I think, among our people in this country, at least an increasing element among our people in this country.
Il faut revoir nos idées sur le problème noir.
I think there's a tendency to see that our problem not as a Negro problem or
notre problème n'est pas un problème uniquement noir. C'est un problème humain. C'est un problème à l'échelle mondiale.
And there's an increasing number of our people who are also beginning to see that our own problem is inseparable from the African problem.
C'est une erreur pour les Noirs américains de penser que leur problème est différent de celui de l'Afrique.
When Africa was colonized, the image of Africa was created.
L'image que nous avions de l'Afrique colonisée était celle des colonisateurs. Elle était fausse. Et nous, Africains d'origine, en acceptant cette fausse image, nous nous sommes reniés nous-mêmes, ce qui pour nous a eu un effet psychologique paralysant.
Well, to me, this put an American Negro in a more strategic position than anyone has been in at the.
Pour défendre sa cause, le noir américain se trouve pour la première fois dans une position stratégique très forte. Et pour moi, la tragédie, c'est de ne pas savoir en profiter.
If the government can't defend us, what should we do? If the government doesn't want us to pick up a rifle, then defend us. Go find out who bombed the church in Birmingham, Alabama. And if they can't find out, then let us go find out. And when we find, I don't want to hear that. And when we find out who it was who murdered our little female babies, then the law of justice is that a murderer should be murdered. That's the law of justice in any land. And if the government can't do it, then let you and I do it.
Black Panther Party. Black Panther Party. Black Power.
Black Power.
Brothers.
Last time, My brothers didn't have no bullets in their guns. I want to clarify that shit right now. We ain't going in like that, goddamn.
Black foul. Black foul.
Black foul.
Everybody heat it up? Yes, heat it up, no? Going in and pour it on. Pour it on. Right. 12. 12. 12.
No.
Anybody got some? Sure. Let's go fall in on Colony 2s. Fall in on Brother Bill, Colony 2s in the street. Go ahead, Brother Bill. You can't make the stuff shots behind the bed. Fall in. Let's go right up there.
Fall in.
Right ready to get it started?
Yes, sir.
Black power.
Black power.
Black power.
Black power.
Let's move out.
Let's move out.
Don't keep it out.
No justice.
No peace.
No justice.
No peace.
What do we want?
Justice.
What do we want?
Justice.
When do we want it?
Now.
When do we want it?
Now.
How are we gonna get it?
By any means necessary.
By any damn means necessary. Black power.
Black power.
Black power.
Black power.
Black
hole!
Black hole!
Black hole!
Black hole! Come on now! I know y'all can get louder than that back there! Black hole!
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 Black hole! Black
hole!
Black hole!
Black hole!
Who are you? Yeah. You don't know. Don't tell me Negro. That's nothing. What were you before the white man named you a Negro? And where were you? And what did you have? What was yours? What language did you speak then? What was your name? It couldn't have been Smith or Jones or Bunch or Powell. That wasn't your name. They don't have those kind of names where you and I came from. No, what was your name?
Yes, sir.
And why don't you now know what your name was then? Where did it go? Where did you lose it?
Yes.
Who took it? And how did he take it? What tongue did you speak?
Yes.
How did the man take your tongue? Where is your history? How did the man wipe out your history? How did the man, what did the man do to make you as dumb as you are right now?
The white man is your enemy, whether you're a Baptist, whether you're a Methodist, whether you're a Episcopalian, or whether you're a Muslim, or whether you're a Mason, or whether you're an elk. If you find yourself running into opposition when you're looking for freedom, justice, and equality, or some kind of right, you have to agree always the one who opposes your right is the white man. The old blue-eyed, blonde-haired, bad-smelling white man. Like you any better than he likes me. Some of you are dumb enough to think that he makes a distinction, that he makes a difference. But in his eyesight, there's no difference. When he puts this club upside your head, he doesn't care whether you're a Baptist, a Methodist, but he does want to know whether or not you're a Muslim. Because he knows if you're a Baptist or a Methodist, you're going to turn the other cheek. You're going to try and love your enemy. You're going to pray for them that they're fightfully use you. So he's not worried about you. But he knows that you're a Muslim, you're not going to turn the other cheek. If you pray for him, you pray that God kills him, or God helps you to kill him. That's the only kind of prayer you pray. So since you and I can
from the same man. It's time for you and me to unite, to get together and get this big white stink off our back. You got a bad habit. You're hooked and don't know it. You got what's known as white disease. You think you can't get along without the white man. You think you can't get some clothes without the white man. You think you can't get a house without the white man. You think you can't even get a job without the white man. You're worse than a man who thinks you can't get along without heroin. You're worse than a man who thinks you can't get along without morphine. You're worse than the junkie. You're in worse shape than the junkie because the junkie only has a little monkey on his back and you're running around with a big white ink named Uncle Sam on your back.
No. If they don't pass it, it'll make him angry, and if they do pass it, it'll make him angry, because most of the trouble that you're having in this country right now is in the North rather than in the South. And I think that any person who has a knowledge of the Civil Rights Bill will agree that it offers the Negro in the North nothing that he doesn't already have. So if that bill is passed, and it still doesn't offer the Northern Negro anything that he has, it means that the present civil rights legislation won't in any way correct the problems that Negroes in the North are facing. So after the bill is passed, the Negro will still be living in the ghetto. He'll still be the unemployed. He'll still be the victim of poor education and poor everything else.
Now, brothers and sisters, we believe that we who declared ourselves to be righteous Muslims should not participate in wars which take the lives of children. As Muslims, we don't go to war. We don't get dressed. We don't join anybody. We don't teach you not to go because they put us in jail for sedition. I would never tell you not to go. I wouldn't be that dumb. But I would sure would tell you if you're dumb enough to go, that's up to you. Fight for someone who means you no good? If you're dumb enough to fight for something that you have never gotten, if you are dumb enough to be as dumb as your other brother who went into Korea and came back and still caught hell, if you're dumb enough to follow in the footsteps of your older brother during World War II, who fought all over the South Pacific, like Isaac Ward, came back here into this country and got his eyes punched out by police right here in this country. If you are dumb enough behind what you know about the white man today, to let him stick his uniform on you and send you overseas to fight, well, you go to hell on fight. But I'm not that dumb. For me, and I can only speak for myself, I'll go to jail. I'll go to prison. Stick me in jail. Let me go to prison. Don't give me your uniform. And don't give me your rifle, because I might use it on someone that you don't intend for me to use. Never put me in your airplane and fill it with bombs and tell me go bomb the enemy. Well, I don't have the power to go to fight that enemy. No! We do not believe that this nation should force us to take part in such war. But we have nothing to gain from it. Unless America agrees to give us necessary territory, where we may then have something to fight for. Give us part of this country. And then if it's attacked, we got something to fight for. But the days are gone when you think you can trap this little black man who's sitting up here in the slums and ghettos of Holland, who receives nothing but the worst schools and the worst education, who can't even get a decent job, why that cracker is out of his mind. If he thinks our people are dumb enough to go right after him today into some kind of war that he's going to instigate and start for his own mercenary benefit. Those days are over. We believe, yes, let him fight his own war. Let him fight his own battle. If you and I can't fight Mississippi, we got no business fighting over someplace else. If we're going to be nonviolent at home, we're going to be nonviolent abroad. We believe that we're at the time now when God, the Prince of Peace, have a desire to set up his kingdom here on this earth. But we do not believe that God can establish a kingdom of peace until he first removes from the planet the warmonger, the war maker, the troublemaker. So today, we believe religiously that God is after the white man, that God is rounding them up, that God is bringing them together, shoving them all in one spot for the sole purpose of casting all of them into the lake of fire. We religiously believe that when you read the book of Revelation, and it points out in there about the beast in the last days that was cast into the lake of fire as Muslims, we believe that this means none other than the American white man. We believe that his future is a fiery future, a future in which he will be enveloped in the flame that will stem from God's wrath. And because we believe this religion, we respect it, but we don't have any desire to be integrated with it. We want to be separated from it. We want to please God. We want to get on God's side, so God will be on our side. We want to make ourselves acceptable to God. We don't want to make ourselves acceptable to the white man. We're not trying to impress the white man. We shake his hand, we show him respect, but we're not trying to make no love with the white man. Let him love his own kind and let us love our own kind. Let him unite his own kind and let us unite our own kind. Let us let him live in his neighborhood and let us live in our neighborhood. Let him run his community and let us run our community. If the white men are going to be in the white community, let us have some black. Let us have some black precincts. Let us have some black merchants. Let us have some black stores. Let us have something black in a black community. We are tired of looking into the face of these blue-eyed exploiters who are taking advantage of our people.
I want to thank Brother Jesse Gray, for the invitation to come here this afternoon and participate in this rally, which I believe is for the good of the community, the good of the black community. And anything that's good for the black community, the white man should realize it is good for his community. Jesse Gray is one of the key persons in the Harlem area, primarily because he's dealing with one of the key problems, the problem of housing. It doesn't make any difference what else you have. If you don't have some place to rest your head, you're in bad shape. Here in Harlem, the reason we say that housing is such a key problem, when you live in a poor neighborhood, you're living in an area where you have to have poor schools. When you have poor schools, you have poor teachers. When you have poor teachers, you get a poor education. And when you get a poor education, you are destined to be a poor man and a poor woman the rest of your life. Poor education, you can only work on a poor paying job. And that poor paying job enables you to live again in a poor neighborhood. So it's a very vicious cycle. And usually these bad housing conditions result from the fact, as Mr. Gray has pointed out, of absentee landlords, people who are rich and live downtown and let you and I live up here in the shack. Actually, it's a form of 20th century slavery. And what you and I have to let the man know is we are peaceful people. We are loving people. We love everybody who loves us. But we don't love anybody who doesn't love us. We're nonviolent with people who are nonviolent with us. But we are not nonviolent with anyone who is violent with us. Once those intentions are made known, we can get to the nitty-gritty of the problem. We can get to the core of the problem. We can get to the root of the problem. And then we can correct the problem. There's been a lot of talk said recently because I was supposed to have said something about Negroes should buy rifles. White people have been buying rifles all their lives. No commotion. I see an editorial right here in a paper they call the Journal of America. One that we happen to have sued against for around $6 million for saying the wrong thing a few years ago. It says that we're supposed to be organizing some kind of Negroes to arm themselves with rifles and shotguns for self-defense. America is based upon the right of people to organize for self-defense. This is in the Constitution of the United States. You read it for yourself. Brother James had the Constitution, he brought the Constitution in with him. I don't know why. What is that now? What article is that? The Second Amendment to the Constitution spells out the right of people under this particular governmental system to have arms to defend themselves. All of you know I'm not an integrationist. I'm a believer in the Honorable Elijah and follower of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I'm still a Muslim. My religion is Islam. I run into some obstacles in the Nation of Islam, and I feel that I can best serve the Honorable Elijah Muhammad's purpose and program and carry into existence what I feel, I understand, concerning his objectives better on the outside than I can on the inside. And now that I have the independence of action, it's my intention to work with everybody or against everybody, whatever the case may be, to try and get some kind of immediate solution to the problems that are confronting our people. I still believe the best thing for us to do is go back home to Africa. But while we're getting ready to go back, we've got to eat now, we've got to sleep now, we have to have some clothes now, our children have to go to school and we need someplace to work. So whatever kind of action program can be devised to get us the things that are ours by right, then I'm for that kind of action no matter what the action is. I don't think when a man is being criminally treated that some criminal has the right to tell that man what tactics to use to get the criminal off his back. When a criminal starts misusing me, I am going to use whatever is necessary to get that criminal off my back. And the injustice that has been inflicted upon Negroes in this country by Uncle Sam is criminal. Don't blame a cracker in Georgia for your injustices. The government is responsible for the injustices. The government can bring these injustices to heart.
Mr. Hilbert, will you have any comment at this time?
But Malcolm's message was not lost on one audience and one man in particular.
So far as the rank and file of the colored population is concerned, maybe some of them do not like the FBI.
In J. Edgar Hoover's day, the FBI got a little crazy on the subject of black people. They had Elijah Muhammad under surveillance for at least 20, 25 years. They had Malcolm under surveillance for most of his public life. When I say surveillance, I'm talking about wiretaps, I'm talking about room bugs, I'm talking about infiltrators.
You were an undercover agent for the police. He didn't know then.
No, he didn't.
And you got in close, very close. He trusted you.
I would say yes.
Gene Roberts got so close that he became Malcolm X's bodyguard, even though he was really an undercover cop in the New York City Police Department.
Your job was to gather intelligence, to gather information.
Yes.
And the Bureau's mission was to keep tabs on potentially violent people?
Yes.
Why was Malcolm X considered a potentially violent, if not in fact violent, person?
Well, I guess at that point in time, society wasn't ready for Malcolm X. He was saying a lot of things that society didn't want to hear at that point in time. The week before he was killed, there was a meeting at the Audubon. And I saw what I thought, and I still think, was a dress rehearsal for Malcolm's impending assassination. I called the department the following morning, and I told them that I felt that this was a, as I put it, a dry run. And they told me that, okay, we'll pass it on and we'd take care of it. What they did with it, I really don't know.
I did not have a gun, but I tell you, I wished I had a gun. Because when I walked into the Ottoman barroom and seen nobody on the door, seen no one there, I became very upset. And I went directly, as I walked to the back of the room, I asked, I said, what is this? And they said, this is his request. He told us not to put nobody on the door. I said, don't give me that. Don't give me that. I said, somebody in here is playing games.
And a commotion started. Two individuals near the front got up and one of them hollered, get your hands out my pocket.
Malcolm said, all right, all right, all right, all right, all right. And all of a sudden, that's when the bullets start ringing.
And I saw three individuals from the front get up and just start firing at him. They came running down the middle aisle toward the exit. I turned and went back, and two of them passed me. And I met the third individual, and just as he turned to fire at me, I turned sideways and hit him with a chair, and I knocked him down. I saw him scramble up, run out the door. I chased him out the door, at which time, when I got out, there was a crowd of people outside. They had him, and they were beating him. I turned around and went back in, and as I got to the stage, he was still laying there, and everybody was standing around. So at that time, I started giving him mouth to mouth, and he died right there on stage.
First, tell me about Dreamer.
Oh, well, when I saw the State of the Black Union, Dick Gregory really moved me and a lot of my friends. I show it to everybody that comes over the house, especially white folks, because they need to hear that, you know, so that they know more about all of us, because what he said affects all of us. He said something that really hit home about this phenomena of chemtrails. And you know, when I was a kid, I used to see these trails in the sky all the time and say, oh, that's cool, a jet just went over. And then you started to see a whole bunch of them, and next thing you know, everybody in your neighborhood was fighting and arguing and you didn't know why. Okay, and you really didn't know why. I mean, everybody was fighting. So he started riffing about the chemtrails, and he started to say things that hit home so hard. And I would recommend that everybody try to get what he said online or wherever, and try to get a copy of it and just listen to it. Because I was so moved that I had to write the song. The other thing is the first line of the song says, I was born on the same plantation, the United States of the Red, White, and Blue. And we live in a place now that feels just about like a plantation. We're all indentured servants, you know. When I found out there were eight presidents before George Washington, I wanted to smack somebody. You know, I wanted to know why I was taught otherwise. Just tell me the whole story. I'll fill in the blanks. But don't tell me something that you think I'm supposed to know.
We're indentured servants and we got a black president now?
Well, I don't vote. I have nothing to do with it. I got no dog in that race.
And for those who would cuss me out and slap me in person if I didn't ask you why?
Well, the reason why is because I'm one of Jehovah's Witnesses, and we've never voted, and that's not to say that I don't think Barack Obama, President Obama, is a very smart individual, and he seems like he means well. Prophecy is what we all have to go by now. It's very interesting. I did a sold-out concert in London. We played 21 nights in a row, and all the concerts were sold out. When I would watch television over there, and you'd see the United Nations feed, the direct feed from the United Nations, you'd hear them talk a lot about religion. You'd hear the Bible mentioned constantly. This is not what we're used to in the United States. It's almost as though there's no need for God and no need for religion and justice in politics. So there's supposed to be a separation of church and state over here. We can't have a separation of state and morality, though. And, you know, songs like Dreamer and even Feel Good, it's the same thing.
Let me, I got good news and bad news. The bad news first, since I like ended on good news. The bad news is I'm out of time for this show. The good news is I think that if I lean on my friendship, I might be able to get Prince to stick around for like another 12 minutes. And if you tune into this program tomorrow night, we can finish our conversation. It's never over, but we'll continue it, talking about these other three songs from the new CD, Lotus Flower. At lotusflower.com, you can get. I want to ask you about these other three songs tomorrow night, and then this fine artist who he referenced earlier, you can take fine anywhere you want to take it. This fine artist he referenced earlier in this conversation, Bria Valente.
Oh.
Yes. Bria will join us tomorrow night as well.
So now
tomorrow
night. Talking.
Yeah, now we're talking. Right. So tomorrow night, part two of our conversation with Prince and Bria Valente with us tomorrow night as well. She's one of the three CDs in this new Lotus Flower package of three CDs. Prince, thank you for coming on.
Thank you.
On the Martin Luther King case, see, like, very few people know about the release of the new documents in the JFK case. Very few people know that there was actually a trial on the murder to kill, on the murder conspiracy to kill Martin Luther King.
A trial?
Yes, there was a trial. And see, hardly anybody knows about this. The media basically ignored it. All right, and the verdict in the case was the jury came back with a verdict of conspiracy in the Martin Luther King case. So now we have a verdict, an adjudicated court verdict in that case that says that Martin Luther King was killed as a result of conspiracy.
Okay, but just so the stick was out there was a jury case,
yes,
on the Martin Luther King assassination.
Right.
Okay, so, I mean, it had been conceded that it was James Earl Ray.
Right.
But another case was held, like an appeal or something, right? Where was this jury held
and
when?
Let me explain how this whole trial came about, since, like I said, very few people know anything about it. what happened was that a man named Lloyd Jowers, who owned a kind of deli in Memphis, went on television with Sam Donaldson, okay, of ABC, in I think 1994, 1995. And he said that he had been a part of a conspiracy to go ahead and kill Martin Luther King, and that James Earl Ray had not been the trigger man, you know, in the conspiracy. Of course, this created a lot of controversy in the case, all right? And so William Pepper, who had been the attorney of record for James Earl Ray, began to pursue this. And so before James Earl Ray died in 1997, he tried to get a new trial based on the new evidence, okay, to go ahead and try the case again. But two things happened down in Memphis, okay? Number one, the judge in the case, Judge Joe Brown, looked like he was actually going to reopen the case. And when that happened, everything went loose. I mean, the city of Memphis, the state of Tennessee, the national media, et cetera, managed to get him removed from that case. And, of course, he went on to become a syndicated judge on daytime TV. Okay,
What's his name?
Judge Joe Brown.
Okay.
He has a Judge Joe Brown show on TV. All right.
So they paid him off with celebrity.
Well, I'm not saying
I know
that.
You didn't say that. I said it. I said it. You didn't say it.
All right. And so he was removed from the case. All right. And so then James Earl Ray died. The state of Tennessee refused to export him to Pittsburgh, which is like 300 miles away, to get a kidney transplant. And so he died before Pepper could conclude the process of trying to get him a new trial. So we covered all this in the magazine, the essays are in the book. So then what happened is the King family, okay, Dexter King, Coretta Scott King, Martin Luther King Jr. and their two sisters, okay, decided to file charges against Lloyd Jowers on this conspiracy count. Okay, this ended up being a civil trial held in Memphis.
Okay, so just to review, Lloyd Jowers is the one who publicly
right.
confessed
right.
to being involved in a conspiracy to kill Martin Luther King.
Correct. Okay. So they went ahead and filed a case, all right, and it was a trial, and I think it lasted about 3 weeks, all right, and the jury came back and said that Jowers was involved. They agreed with the Kings that Jowers was involved in a conspiracy to kill Martin Luther King, all right? And so we, by the way, this is very interesting. Everybody remembers the whole O.J. Simpson case debacle, in which you had something like, I don't know, anywhere from 500 to 2,000 journalists camped in L.A. covering this so-called great trial of the century, et cetera, all right? Well, here you really did have a really important trial down in Memphis, correct? All right? And do you know how many journalists were actually in that room every single day of the trial? One. Ours.
Yours?
Jim Douglas, yeah. Jim Douglas, who did the reporting on that for Probe Magazine, was the only journalist in the courtroom every day.
Well, let me challenge you for a second. Now, without revealing all the details, because there's too much to go over, and people got to buy the book and read it, or they can go search on the internet if they don't want to read the book. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, what's the big deal if it wasn't James Earl Ray, but it was like the Knights of Columbus or some other rednecks down there or some Klansmen or some good old boys who decided to knock off King? All right, you know, it's unfortunate and it's big, but it's not a big political issue.
Oh, I couldn't disagree more.
Why not?
I couldn't disagree more. Because, first of all, you have to ask the question, well, why did they frame James Earl Ray? Why did they not allow him a trial? You know, why did he serve, you know, 30 years in jail, you know, if he didn't do it, okay? And then you have to ask, well, then if he didn't do it, who did it and how come they killed him? And why did that particular assassination, and it's another thing most people don't understand. The assassination of Martin Luther King is April the 4th, 1968. The assassination of Robert F. Kennedy here in Los Angeles took place almost precisely 60 days later, on June the 4th, 1968. Okay? Now, I ask you, was that a coincidence that both these people died under mysterious circumstances, 2 months apart, in cases that, if they were tried in open court today, would not, you know, they wouldn't go beyond a week? It's clearly both cases were the result of a conspiracy. All right, so I think it's important politically, you know, and historically, and that's why we wrote this book, especially the afterword, as to what happened in America and why we face the circumstances we do today.
You're saying that there was it wasn't, let's say, race hatred or revenge?
No,
or
no.
If there was a
point. The evidence produced in court says that it was a grand conspiracy between the Central Intelligence Agency, okay, the Pentagon, and the Mafia in order to kill King. That's the stuff that Pepper produced in court.
The CIA?
Yes. The Mafia.
The Mafia.
Okay, and the Pentagon.
And the Pentagon.
Right.
And those are actually three separate organizations.
Okay.
Really?
Yes.
At the time that occurred, 68, just to refresh everybody's memory, who was the reigning president at the time? Whose watch was that?
Okay, well, in April 1968, Lyndon Johnson, okay, was the ostensible president, but he was basically on his way out, okay? And Robert Kennedy, of course, was running for president and would have probably been president if he would not have been assassinated.
So all four major assassinations occurred under Johnson's watch.
No.
I mean, well, he started as the vice president. Kennedy was assassinated,
yeah,
and he became the president.
Right, right.
And then
exactly, right.
And then you got Malcolm X and Martin Luther King,
JFK.
JFK
63, Malcolm X is 1965. So, yeah, Johnson was the vice president when Kennedy was assassinated, and he was the president when Malcolm was killed. Right.
And he was the president when, and who was the president when King was killed? Johnson.
Right.
So it's Johnson all the way.
He was the vice president and the president, correct.
It's an interesting little fact. Okay. So you're saying that part of significance of the loss, and, you know, there's a great loss to humanity of Martin Luther King.
Right.
You know, you just listen to the tapes. They're unparalleled
right.
in history for rhetorical skill and everything.
Mm-hmm.
But in addition,
it goes further than that because as I tried to explain in the book, towards the end of his life, from, say, 1967 to 1968, it's a much different Martin Luther King than from the early days from Montgomery to Selma to even the March on Washington, the great, what most people, including myself, believe is the whole high point of both the Kennedy presidency and the Civil Rights Movement, that great oration that he gave, you know, in Washington in 1963. The latter day Martin Luther King, 67-68, is different both as a man, as a thinker, as an activist. He's broadened out a long way from the civil rights movement, from voter registration, from integration, and he's broadening he's become the anti-war person. Again, this is what drives the wedge between him and Johnson. Okay, is that King, I think in 1966 or 67, makes this great anti-Vietnam speech in New York. Okay, and then he fights against the war.
At Riverside Church.
Right. He calls the United States the greatest purveyor of violence in the world today. All right, then he also is preparing this Poor People's March in 1968. He's broadening his scope, not just a black-white issue, okay, but a wide economic issue about the distribution of wealth, you know, in the United States. And I think in 1967 he makes his quote about, you know, we have to have a revolution in political values in this country. And so he becomes like RFK, he becomes more radicalized towards the end of his life. And you can see the influence of Malcolm on Martin Luther King.
Well, how do you mean that?
Because, well, Malcolm was always pictured as this revolutionary, as outside the mainstream, you know, of political discourse, you know, in this country. Because he said things like that. We have to have a revolution in values in this country. And that kind of, that saying something like that in public puts you outside the box, okay? You know, you become caricatured as, you know, as kind of beyond the fringe, etc. Okay, well, King is actually talking like this in 1967 and 1968, okay? So he's kind of going beyond, you know, the guy who could get on TV and talk about civil rights, which, of course, everybody was for, you know, even back then, all right? You know, sooner or later it was going to have to happen. Well, he's going outside that, and he actually understood this, by the way, you know, that because other people are starting to criticize him for going beyond what he started as. You know, he's actually torn about this, but he decided to go ahead, you know, and do it anyway. All right, Robert Byrd, everybody likes Bob Byrd today.
Yeah, right.
Because he made a lot of really good speeches about Iraq. Take a look at the speeches he made about King in 1967 and 1968 in preparation for the...
Well, Byrd was a Klansman.
He was a former Klansman, right, for the Poor People's March on Washington. He was being viciously... He was attacking King about this whole thing. Didn't like the idea, you know, of people like camping out in Washington arguing about economic distribution of wealth in the United States at that time.
But what you're saying is he went across the bridge from racial, you know,
right,
creating a remedy to racial discord. He went over towards
right.
class struggle.
Correct.
Like, you know, and I mean class struggle, I'm not a communist, but I'm talking about the fair, equitable distribution.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You get paid for the work you do. It doesn't all go to the owner.
And right, and this directly affected him, of course, because he actually, one of the reasons he was so anti-war is because, as most people who study history, Johnson's Great Society programs were being destroyed by the Vietnam War because there was so much money being spent on that war, okay, there wasn't enough money to do the follow through the things that he wanted to do with the Great Society programs. And King went after him on specifically that issue.
But Johnson was controlling it. So he was sacrificing
Johnson's
his domestic...
controlling...
The budget. He was sacrificing his domestic agenda to feed the war.
Right.
You'd think Johnson was in control.
Then you get into the whole issue of, was he really running the Vietnam War? You know, and he actually thought that he was being a victim of the Vietnam War. That's the way he saw himself as. That he'd been lied to, deceived so many times by McNamara and the Joint Chiefs of Staff, etc., that he got totally out of control. He actually said that towards the end of his life. You know, they basically bamboozled me on this whole Vietnam War, and it destroyed my presidency.
Right.
Yeah.
So King goes over the bridge towards taking a broader scope.
Correct.
Beyond just let's learn to love each other.
Right.
To like let's look at the consequences of an unequitable society or mm-hmm. You know, whatever it is, right?
Mm-hmm.
And also the use of foreign wars to control domestic policy.
Right.
So I'm just curious. This is something I've never thought of before, honestly, and just right now. In King's speech towards the end, when he was presaging or foretelling, you know, they're going to get me and I'm not mm-hmm. afraid, right? I think
right.
that was the last speech he made. The night before he died, it's, mm-hmm. you know, there's someone, I don't want to try to paraphrase it, I don't know it.
Mm-hmm.
But he said he's not afraid mm-hmm. and he's aware that they're after him. And I always, in my mind, envision that as like, you know, some Southern racists.
Mm-hmm.
But it's possible that there were other forces that he was aware of,
oh,
that
yes.
He was picking on a big enemy.
Yeah, there's no doubt he was aware of it. In fact, When he saw the JFK assassination sitting next to his wife on TV down in Atlanta, okay, when he heard the news about it, okay, you know, he actually told her, he said, that's exactly what they're going to do to me. All right.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
So in your book, are you going over the evidence?
We went through the whole trial, all the evidence actually presented at the trial. Okay, and we went through the whole thing before that, what Pepper was trying to introduce into evidence to actually reopen the case, the bullet test on the supposed rifle used by James Earl Ray that the Tennessee authorities say he used to kill King. And that's what he was trying to get Joe Brown to do, to retest the rifle to see if the so-called fatal bullet that killed King really did come from that rifle. Because every test done up until that time had come back, quote, inconclusive. They can't say yes, they can't say no. So he wanted to go ahead and make the ultimate test by cleaning out the barrel of the rifle to see if the markings were actually done by that rifle. And that's precisely at the point he was stopped. So, you know, if you have nothing to hide, you go ahead and do all the tests. In my opinion, the Tennessee authorities knew that if they went beyond that step, the test would come back that it wasn't that bullet that came from that rifle. Therefore, Ray did not kill King. And that's why they stopped the testing.
But there's supporting evidence for to indicate a conspiracy besides just the rifle.
Oh, there's much more. Yes. And that's the stuff that got brought into the record at the civil trial.
All the stuff about the police department.
Right, the police department dropping back, about the mowing down of the foliage, okay, that would have hit an assassin below the hotel, okay, instead of above the hotel, of the changing of King's room, okay, from the first floor to the second floor, of Hoover's message to his media assets, broadcasting that King stays at the Holiday Inn. What is a black man doing staying at a white middle-class hotel when there's plenty of black hotels in Memphis, and that's what moved him to the Lorraine Motel. And then somebody came in a week before he was going to arrive there and moved him from the first floor to the second floor. The significance of that, of course, is that the first floor had an interior courtyard. No assassin could have killed him there. Okay, you go to the second floor, has the exterior balcony where he's an exposed target. Okay, and so that of course is the whole setup, you know, of the assassination.
So it indicates predetermined intent.
Right,
this is
he's moving around.
It's not off the cuff, just, oh, let's go do it. This was planned out.
Correct.
With many people involved.
Right, and then the guy who's actually standing over his body, Merrill McCullough, who's supposed to be a part of this invaders group, which is modeled on the Black Panthers. Okay, there's a famous picture of King, and this guy's standing over his dead body. Okay, and he's pointing at where James Earl Ray is supposed to be. Okay, across the street. All right, and this kid's name is Merrill McCullough, and like I said, he had been supposedly part of this group called the Invaders, modeled on the Black Panthers. It turns out that Merrill McCullough had been an informant for the Memphis Police Department, had been working for the FBI also. When Sam Donaldson heard about this, okay, he says, you're not going to tell me, like smiling, that this Merrill, you're not going to say Merrill McCullough works for the Central Intelligence Agency, do you? And they said, that's what we're saying. So on national TV, Sam Donaldson calls up CIA headquarters, okay, and he gets the desk officer there, and he goes, do you have a man named Merrill McCullough that works there? And the guy looks, doesn't know what's happening, so he looks at the roster and he goes, let's see. Yeah, we do. Because do you mind if I talk to him? So McCullough comes in the telephone, and Donaldson asks, are you the Merrill McCullough who's in that famous picture of Martin Luther King when he's dying on the balcony of the Lorraine Motel? And he goes, yes. And he goes, and you work for the Central Intelligence Agency? And he goes, yes. How long have you worked for the CIA? 17 years. All right. So now we have the guy standing over King's that pointing to the wrong place, we now know was an undercover agent. Okay? All these years. We weren't allowed to know that. Okay? Now, why that's important is because the reason he ends up in Memphis at all is because the invaders had broken up his first demonstration in Memphis, okay, for the sanitation workers there. He'd been down there in late March. The invaders break up that demonstration. Okay? They start throwing cans through windows, et cetera. And that's what brings him back, because he felt so bad and it turned out so badly that that's why he comes back. So you're left with the supposition, did McCullough do this on purpose to bring King back as part of the setup that eventually moves him into the Valerian Motel, moves him on the second floor, and then he's there pointing in the wrong place at this patsy, James Earl Ray.
Okay, Jim. Jim?
Yes.
You brought us to a climax. That's incredible. And I'd read the Pepper book, and I didn't get that. I don't know if it's in a Pepper book or not.
Okay.
About that. What's his name again?
Merrill McCullough.
Merrill McCullough. If it was in there, it wasn't pronounced the way you just did. Mm-hmm. So we're out of time. You know how that happens on these shows. We'll have to do some more shows. But I just want to say something to the audience there. Thanks for watching. Keep those emails coming in. And I usually tell you to go out and do something good for somebody. But this time, I want you to go out there and get yourself educated. Find out what happened. You have a responsibility to history to know the truth, what really went down. So get this book. It's called The Assassinations. And you go find it somewhere. Thanks for watching. See you next time.
It's not about justice. It's not about agenda. It's not about mobilizing people. It's about dialing for corporate dollars. These two parties have sold the U.S. government and the American people to the highest bidders.
The Baltimore protests and riots were, as you know, spawned following the murder of Freddie Gray by police. But no one would have even known about the police treatment of Gray if it weren't for one brave man, Kevin Moore, who took video of the arrest. So the city of Baltimore took the time last week to show their gratitude to Kevin Moore. But they didn't give him the key to the city. They instead gave him a whole jail cell. They arrested him. But how else can you show thanks to someone who has held murderers accountable than by surrounding him by riot cops and locking him up? I'm pretty sure it's the same way they honored the Baltimore Ravens following their Super Bowl win. I'm pretty sure. They held Kevin Moore for seven hours, and then released him without charges. Sure, some of the empathy pants liberals are claiming this is police intimidation, but what's the root of the word intimidation? Intimate. The cops were just getting intimate with Baltimore's hero. They probably needed time for autographs and selfies and the such, you know? This is nothing new. Similar celebratory procedures have been followed with other people who revealed police and government wrongdoing. The man who filmed Eric Garner being strangled by police for selling a cigarette, Ramsey Orta, was arrested soon afterward for festive reasons, I'm sure. Even his wife was given the same hero's welcome. You know, hero's treatment. The man who revealed the CIA torture program, John Kiriakou, was locked up for 30 months of high fives and sensual massages, I would imagine. And then, of course, there's Chelsea Manning spending 35 years in her reward chambers. And Edward Snowden and Julian Assange, they showed us exactly how much our government has been doing without our consent. And for that, we sent them on all expenses paid vacations to London and Moscow.
To bring them into major confrontation. The rival powers convened around a conference table in the German capital, and in February 1885 signed the Act of Berlin, an agreement to abolish slavery and allow free trade. But the Act also drew new borders on the map of Africa, awarding territory to each European power and turning trading partners into subjects of empire. It legalized the scramble for Africa.
What it did was it carved up what are thought to have been about between 6,000 and 10,000 political units in Africa, and they were then carved up, often cutting peoples in half, water tables just sort of cut off from their sources. It was complete geographical madness. Simply drew lines on the map, places where they had not even been yet. They had no idea what was there.
Africans were not aware that there were conferences being organized in Berlin to determine about them. No, they did not know about it. They only saw the consequences.
But the governments of Europe were at pains to stress that their forays into Africa weren't just the product of vested interest. That beneath train tracks and shipping lanes lay a moral justification which caught the public imagination.
And they justified it by saying that they were bringing civilization and Christianity to these benighted, primitive people?
A white man's burden, beautiful language. So the European politician and the theoretician of colonialism to explain to their people why should we send our children to Tonkin, the Gulf of Tonkin, to Vietnam? Why should we send them to die in the malaria-infested part of Algeria or Black Africa and so on? White man's burden. We have to bring them the light.
A partnership with the church in Africa offered the colonialists an insight into living conditions and the social services that would be expected of a supposedly benevolent empire. But it also delivered a moral pretext. Europe had long harbored an image of the dark continent, wild, exotic, and in need of enlightenment. For Christian missionaries and for many colonialists, their project was a humanitarian one.
I didn't see the colonial service as racist. After all, I'd come across real racism in southern Rhodesia and South Africa. Well, when I was at school in South Africa, I had no African friends. There was no-